non-relationship. I want to, before we get started today, if you don't mind, I want to just do a quick commercial of sorts. It is our desire here at Faith Church to equip you with the best tools to put in your Bible toolbox for your learning and growing an understanding of God and His Word. And that's why we have a resource room in there with a lot of books and resources and Bibles of sorts. I just ordered some new ones this week, so I'm going to want to call your attention to that before you leave today. And specifically, every once in a while, I'll recommend a specific book, and I never order enough. It's kind of the same way today, so the second service, by the time you get this announcement, you always kind of, I don't know, get hosed a little bit because there are service goes in there and buys them out. But there's two books I want to recommend to you, and for those of you that don't get there fast enough today that want them, I will order more for you. But I just finished a book this week called Heaven, How I Got Here. As a matter of fact, I was picked it up. I was intrigued by it when I saw it was on sale on one of the websites that I normally frequent. It's a bookstore kind of website. And I saw it on sale, started reading the preview of it, and really, it kind of, you know, I kind of started liking it, so I said, okay, I'm going to get it, and I did, and I just was going to kind of peruse through the table of contents in the introduction during the Monday Night Football game, and before I knew it, the Monday Night Football game was on mute, and I read all 92 pages in the first half, and I said, that's awesome. It was just one of those books that quickly captivated me. Heaven, How I Got Here, The Story of the Thief on the Cross. We don't hear a lot about him. There's not a lot about him in the scriptures, but this author, Colin Smith, reminded us that the only parts that he ever saw of Jesus was his suffering on the cross. And it compelled him. This, we're talking about a robber, a criminal, a zealot against Rome, someone deserving of their crucifixion and their death. And he hangs there on the cross, and he witnesses, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And his heart broke. And so the story of the thief on the cross, heaven, how I got here. And it kind of plays it out within a one-day kind of experience, from breakfast in a dungeon to the carrying of the cross to the nails on the cross. A great little book. I had 15 of them. And that early service took 11. All right, so there's four left. Please don't get up during the sermon and rush in there, but I think you'll enjoy it. And but get it. There goes one right there. She's going to go get it. All right? So now, I'm sorry, there's three left. There goes two. So there's two left. All right? That's the way that's going. I have a children's book that I want to recommend to you. I've done this before with a couple others, and I think you've really enjoyed them. This one's called That's When I Talk to God. It is a beautiful little book of a mom and daughter tucking their little girl in at night and praying and teaching her daughter how to pray. And I was intrigued by it. You know, picked it up, got it on sale, and read through it, practiced on my little 8-year-old daughter, and tucked her in, and we read this book together. And it became a really, really great informational tool to use with our kiddos on how to pray. We normally pray with our kids before a meal or when we tuck them in at night, and that's about it. But this little story talks about and teaching your little ones that you can pray when you look outside and see a beautiful sunset. You can thank God. That's a prayer time. For your friends that you have, when you're lonely, when you're afraid, just all kinds of different things. And the little girl keeps saying, I can pray even now. And the mom says, yes. You can pray because you're afraid of the playground. You can pray because you're... And man, just a beautiful story. It's not very long. Like I said, it's a very thin little book. But it's a big hardback with nice little graphics and illustrations in it. I think that one's 7 and this one's 5. If they're not in there when you get there by the end of the service today, come and let me know. And depending upon how many people let me know that they want them, I'll order some more this week. Because I really think our resource room needs these kind of tools. Okay? Groovy?
Yeah.
Good deal? All right. Enough of the commercials. Let's get to preaching. All right? I have, let me just tell you this up front today. The beautiful part about teaching the way we're teaching right now, going through a book of the Bible, is that when you don't get finished, you just pick up from there and you keep moving on. Many times we preach we've been very series-driven, and we've preached either an expositive text or a topic of some sort, and I feel like I've got to get finished today so I can get on to the next topic or the next thing next week. And what I've been disciplining myself to do is not to just read expositionally and study expositionally. And when I say exposition, it is a study habit that you begin to develop to teach, that you're teaching word by word, verse by verse through the Bible, endeavoring to find out what the original author is trying to tell the original audience. Now, I don't know if you noticed it yet or not, but a lot of our songs have kind of gone together today, all right? And as you see, and as you're going to continue to see throughout the preaching time today, is this, that the same power that rose Jesus from the grave is the same power that lives in us today. Amen? The Spirit of God, that the same power that moves mountains when He speaks and calms raging seas, lives in us. Guess what? The same power that inspired Peter to write to an ancient audience 2,000 years ago could have been written yesterday for us today. We're going to see that in the Scriptures today. So I'm just going to preface this sermon by saying there's a really, really good chance that I'm not going to finish. So for some of you OCD folks out there that have to have your fill-in-the-blanks done, and you know who you are, don't worry about it, but you got to come back next week, all right? I'm not going to give them to you at the end of the service today. You got to come back next week to get your next fill-in-the-blanks. You know who you are, you know what that's all about, all right? Now, in a way of review, we just began 2 Peter last week, and so what we do is we're going to go verse by verse, word by word through this, picking out some of the rich doctrines of the Bible. To us, they're rich doctrines of the Bible. To Peter, he's writing an urgent letter to some persecuted Christians, trying to let them know that, look, false teaching is coming into the church, and it's going to divide you, and when it divides you, it's going to overwhelm you, and when you're overwhelmed, you're going to find yourself in the possibility of not losing your salvation, because that's not possible. But what you're going to find out is that you may realize that, man, I just kind of came along with the crowd, and I was never saved in the first place. Be careful. Watch out for the false teachers and for the false doctrines in the church, because they will seep in. Not all the time will they come in and will they put on a coat and tie and put a big button on there that says false teacher and preach to you heresy on purpose. Many times they come in and they look good and they sound good and everything seems to be right, but it's just not the truth. And they may write a book and it may sell millions of copies, but it's still not the truth. They may plant a church, and there may be thousands upon thousands that attend this to where it eventually becomes called a mega church. I don't see a lot of mega gospel in it or a lot of mega teaching in it. I just see a mega building with mega people in it. And before you know it, you've succumbed to doctrinal error or false teaching. And I'm not pleased. I got off on that. I don't mean to say that the mega churches are teaching on false gospel. I don't mean that. There's some really, really fine ones that are doing a great work out there, and I would support that. Some of them are still large after they planted church after church after church, and they're still big, and God is blessing that. I don't want to say that. But I do want to caution us with this. As a way of review, get back into where Peter began last week, we must understand that as we continue to go throughout the Scripture, it's important for you to read and to study and to learn and to meditate and to really wrestle with some of the things that we're talking about. Because if you don't, you can sit here and take my word for it. I can sell you a car and you can just be on your way and whatever. It's not life-changing. But the Word of God is life-changing. It's inspirational. It's empowering. And the same power that led Peter to write his letters, the same power that we read and understand it today. Okay? So, as you're making your way to 2 Peter, if you have already, let me just give you some thoughts of review here. Last week we talked about in the understanding of knowledge and being able to grow and know it. And this is the phrase or the motto or the sub-theme that's going to be across our whole teaching time here. And again, we're going to try to get through as much as we can. But the theme of 2 Peter is growing and knowing Him. Growing and knowing who Jesus is. And last week we discovered that who we know and what we know really helps define who we are. And that's why it's so vital for us to understand in the Scriptures who we are, who Jesus is, that we can find truth and then live in the truth. Last week I shared this quote with you. In our 21st century context, there's an overabundance of religious choices. And choice after choice dilutes, softens, or outright abandons the absolute necessity of belief in Jesus. This time last year, we began a sermon series on the true or false. We were examining the world religions. You remember that? We were looking at Hinduism. We were looking at Buddhism. We were looking at Islam. We were looking at Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons. We were looking at all these world religions that are dominating the world today. And we were trying to find out what's right and what's wrong, what's true and what's false. And inevitably, they would have this belief system. And all the belief systems sound really good. Moral things and things that we should strive to be and that are across the board. But every single one of the world's religions stumble over the identity of Jesus. In answering the question, who is Jesus, they stumble, and all of a sudden it's not all roads lead to heaven, not all roads lead to God, all roads lead to Jesus Christ, and so many begin to stumble over this rock of events. Why is that? As I said last week, most of us want a Savior, we just don't want a Lord. We don't want anybody to boss us around, right? We don't want a perfect standard. We want to know that we can be who we are and do the things that we do and fall down and pick ourselves back up and no one's the wiser and nothing's any different. We want a Savior, but we don't want a Lord. And so Jesus becomes a stumbling block. He becomes an offense to us. I said last week, MacArthur, we shared this quote with you, never has Peter's warning been more timely to us than it is today. The rapid advancement of mass media, coupled with the church's lack of discernment, has allowed doctrinal error to come in and spread like wildfire. Yet instead of countering error, the church has either embraced it, ignored it, in the name of tolerance. So it could have been written yesterday, huh? Mass media coupled with the church's lack of discernment. Why is the church's lack of discernment so much a key issue? Because where else are you going to find the truth like this? Where else can you open up the book and begin to expound an expository scripture like this, word for word, verse by verse? Thus saith the Lord. And when we understand that now, thus liveth the Rouse. Way it needs to be. But if we're not teaching it and we don't live it, then how will they know? How will they know the truth? Before long, you see, doctrinal error, if it's embraced, if sin is tolerated, if you're not going to deal with the things appropriately and biblically, before long the church becomes too ignorant of the truth, too impotent to change. This great facility that we get to meet in, this great family and friends that we are surrounded by, the things of the scripture, the things that we get to share and fellowship in. What good is it if we don't know Him? Once again, I'll remember the words of the video there. It's not about a religion, it's about a relationship. Who we know and what we know helps define who we are. But we asked ourselves the question last week, how can we recognize the false and how can we counsel towards righteousness if we don't have a knowledge of God and His Word? God's Word is a revelation of Jesus Christ. Plenty of people have scriptures in their heads, but they have no love in their heart for Jesus. How do you recognize the false? I reminded you in two ways last week. I reminded you this. False religions and false teaching, you'll be able to tell them. Why? Because they're always looking for another way around the cross. They never want to go through the cross. And secondly, you can always recognize false religion and false teaching and doctrinal error because it's always quick to find an alternative view of Christ. All roads lead to glory. All roads lead to heaven. We're all God's children. We don't need to follow Him. Jesus will flat out hurt your feelings. We're always looking for an easier, more accommodating way, aren't we? Something to find, you know, a pill to swallow, a drink to drink, a drug to shoot or smoke. It's just mind-boggling how quick we are to look for something easier. And then Jesus becomes a stumbling block to us. Peter reminds us, he reminds us 13 times. 13 times Peter uses the word knowledge. in his small second letter to these churches. Knowledge is your first fill in the blank today, and it was meant to remind the people and to combat the counterfeit message of Satan. The Greek word that is used for this is epignosis, and it's up here on the screen so you can spell it right. You know, we learned from Greek that gnosis means knowledge. So when you meet a Gnostic with a capital G that's silent, you meet a Gnostic, then you're meeting someone who is pursuing knowledge. They want to know all the whys. They want to know that all the how-tos, and they're looking for all the things in the world to give them knowledge, a personal worldview, the world's religions, and they try to mix them all up in this pot. And they say, okay, Islam says this, and Christianity says this, and Buddhism says this. I'm going to take all those and mix them up, and there is going to be the right picture of faith. There's going to be what gets me to heaven. That's called a Gnostic. And then you've met plenty of agnostics. What does that mean? It means without knowledge. They have no view or no worldview or knowledge of God, so they're fine with that. I'm an agnostic. I don't believe. I don't know Him. The atheists are the ones that are without God and completely reject that there is a God. An agnostic is a little bit different than that. It just has no knowledge of God. But when Peter uses this word over and over and over again, epignosis, this prefix to gnosis, is meant to take the word knowledge and make it a deeper, richer, fuller understanding. It's the difference between knowing your fiancé and talking and having great conversations and then becoming married, entering into a covenant together and sharing a different kind of intimacy. Epignosis. Wearsby calls it a living participation in the truth. This participation that I know it's true and I'm going to participate in it and I'm going to give my life to it. That's the knowledge that we're talking about. But knowing the Lord in salvation is just the starting point, you see. Because once you've understood who God is, once you've heard the gospel, applied the gospel, responded to the gospel, and come, this is the starting line for salvation. But salvation doesn't end on the day that you bow your knee and that you pray and ask Jesus in your heart. Salvation continues on. There should be a pursuit of greater knowledge. This is what we call the church sanctification. This is an understanding of how to become more like Jesus. And in becoming more like Jesus, you deepen your understanding of Him, and then epignosis happens in your life. You can pick up the book today and read it after you've been saved for 1 year, 10 years, or 20 years, and you begin to read it and begin to think, okay, I think I get this part. And then you walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And then you walk through the fire. And then you walk through the flood. And you realize that the promise in Isaiah 43 is true. I walked through the fire and was not scorched. I walked through the flood and was not overwhelmed. I walked through the valley of the shadow of death, and He was with me. Do you know Him better today than you did yesterday? Absolutely. That's the case. To know Him, epignosis, to grow in knowing Him. And in verse 1, Peter, we're going to find out again that he identifies himself and said, this is who I am and this is who I'm writing to. And in verse 2, Peter begins to pray for his readers, and we saw that last week. But in verse 3 and 4, which is going to be the primary teaching points today, is this. Peter saying that there's blessing and there's resources from knowing who Christ is. Okay? Let's pick it up today. Okay? 2 Peter chapter 1, if you would stand with me, please, in honor of reading God's Word together. And if you come in today, I don't know, I see a lot of Bibles in here. That's really, really great. I want to make sure that everybody has a copy of God's Word. Chris has got some over here. Dave, be ready to hand some out. If you need a copy of God's Word, if you need something to read along with, raise your hand, we'll bring it to you, okay? It'll be all right. You may have left it in the car. You may have left it at home. Right there. You got one right there? Those are both Spanish Bibles. If you need a Spanish Bible, we've got those as well. All right? We may have some on the back table over there. I want to make sure everybody gets this. If you're unfamiliar with Scripture, all right, 2 Peter is in the back. So go back to the maps, turn back to the left into Revelation, and keep thumbing back a few pages. And 2 Peter is toward the back, all right? Revelation, then you're going to come through Jude and the three Johns, and then you're going to get to 2 Peter. It's right there close to Revelation. If you're borrowing one of our copies, page 1215. Okay? That's where we are. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Let's begin. Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have received a faith of the same kind as ours. So we know that Peter's writing it. Who's he writing it to? He's writing it to Christians. The ones who have a faith The same kind as ours. He says, by the righteousness of God our Savior and Jesus Christ. Verse 2 is his prayer. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge, there's epinosis, in the epinosis of God and of Jesus our Lord. And here's the blessings. Seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness. Through the true knowledge, there it is again, of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, this is your word. Make it a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. May your Spirit teach us and bring us understanding today, that we may know beyond a shadow of a doubt, once we have left this place, we have closed the book. And Lord, you're with us, and you're in us, you desire a relationship with us, and you are here to teach and guide us. Thank you, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. In verse 3, Peter says, seeing that his divine power, I haven't put all my notes in yours today. I'm going to get, we've got to move a little bit quickly, but I'll put my notes with my commentary up here on the screen. If you want to write that in, give me a little bit of margin to write that in your notes today. So when we're talking about exposition, we find key things in these verses that need to mean something to us, that they help us put the whole picture together. So I want to make sure, and this is an opportunity for you to learn how to study the Bible. Sometimes it's easy to just write out the verse or type out the verse to give you some margin in between, and then start defining terms. So my first thing is, right as I got into the verse, is seeing that his, who is his? Are we talking about God the Father? Are we talking about Jesus? Are we talking about the Spirit? His divine power, we're talking about Jesus. Seeing that his divine power, and that is closely related to verse 1 and 2. Alright? So his divine power has granted us, has gifted to us, has given to us. Us, meaning you can circle that, means all believers. Now for Peter, writing the original letter, he's writing to those folks. So when they read the letter for the first time, he's saying, Peter's talking to us, believers, faith of the same kind, the same ones that he called elect or chosen in his first letter. That's who he's writing to the church, the true believers. The beautiful part about this is we can read it now 2,000 years later and realize that the Spirit is saying the same thing to us, and we are included in the us. So Jesus' divine power has given to all believers everything that we need. Everything, it says, pertaining to life and godliness. When you look at life, we're talking about eternal life. When we're looking at godliness, we're talking about an obedient life. Okay? Through life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. And I want to just pause on those last two words, glory and excellence. This is the divine nature of God. We're going to find out in verse 4. The divine nature of God is glory and excellence. His glory is what attracts us to him. His excellence is what makes us want to praise him and call him your honor, my Lord, my Savior, my God, the one whom I trust in. I proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. That is who he is. That is his DNA. That is his structure. That is his nature now revealed to us. And I read this quote this week. It said author unknown, so I don't know who wrote it. But check this out. It, responding to his nature, it says, I looked into his face and was forever spoiled for anything that was unlike him. I looked into the face of God. I looked into the face of my Savior and was forever spoiled for anything that was unlike him. I'm wondering how old this author was, and if the author or composer of the song Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus was referring to that. You remember what he said? Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of this earth will grow what? Strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His glory and excellence and grace and mercy all define his character and his nature. It says that we have been called by that. Everything pertaining to life and God. Let's look at that word, everything. What is everything? What does that mean? Everything that we could possibly need. This is what is the word that we use called sufficiency. We say the Bible is sufficient to meet your every need. This is what we're talking about. This is the backbone, really, of our biblical counseling ministry. Are you lonely and afraid? and afraid? The Bible speaks to that. Are you depressed and hopeless and helpless? The Bible speaks to that. Are you going through relationship troubles? The Bible speaks to that. The thing is that most Christians, they won't deny this fact, but they fail to grasp its reality in their life and in their living. We're quick to say, yes, God can do, but I don't necessarily have the faith and the trust that He will do. Have I been there before? I have. So when we fail to grasp its reality in our life, what happens is we tend to take matters in our own hands. We tend to kind of want to help God along in the sanctification process. That God can handle these parts over here, but I guess He doesn't care about this stuff, so I'm going to have to kind of do that on my own. Before you know it, we slip into sin. We slip into selfishness. Even when it comes to salvation. We understand that Jesus died on the cross and He rose from the grave on the third day, and we realize that He is the agent of creation, so the worlds have come into existence because of Him. Because of His blood on the cross, He redeemed mankind. Because He redeemed mankind, He was brought to power up through His power on the third day and then ascended into the Father. Praise be unto God. Look what He can do. But, well, my bills are getting a little bit out of hand. I'm going to have to take out a loan. He can't handle that part. I need a new job, and even though this one's going to take me away from my family most of the time and definitely take me out of church on Sundays, I need to take that job. And all of a sudden, we start picking things up that God can't handle. Even in the salvation process, He's capable of doing all these things, but we're waiting for something more. And so these false doctrines of second blessings and spirit baptism and tongues and mystical experiences and special insights and revelations, dreams and visions, miracles, demon binding and casting out, we're kind of all waiting for something else to happen before we know we're really saved. I'll tell you this. I believe beyond a shadow of doubt that everything pertaining to life and godliness has been given to me unto salvation. I believe that I'm born again. I believe that I have achieved the right to become a child of God through the work of the cross. I believe all that. I also believe that I do not have the gift of tongues. But I do believe this. I believe that if God allows me to go overseas and speak to a people group that do not know English, and I'm sharing Scripture, or I'm singing Jesus Loves Me, and they begin to hear it and understand it in their own language, is there any gift or any power in me that's done that? No, but even though I can't speak in tongues, does God still speak in tongues?
Yes.
Yes. Even though I can't put my hands on you and work a miracle, can God still do that? Absolutely, He still can. And yet we're waiting for some kind of supernatural, mystical experience to complete our salvation. And that's just not the case. God's still in the miracle-working business. He's still in the gospel-sharing business. He's still working through these broken crackpots that we are right now, these dirty, wounded vessels that we are, and He still uses us to do those things. That's part of the miracle. How in the world could God want to and desire to use somebody like me to share the gospel? I don't know. There's nothing special in me. There's lots of things that I'm good at and physically pretty good at, but none of that matters when it comes to sharing the gospel. Look what He can do. We must know Him. Be in relationship with Him. All things pertaining to life and godliness He's given to us. When we talk about sufficient, we're understanding that God has made full provision for us to have a life of holiness. He's given us His Word, His Spirit. We'll see in verse 4, His nature. We've understood His divine power. Do you know why we sang the song this morning, the same power? It's because right here in verse 3, we're talking about His divine power. The one that raised Jesus from the dead is the one that gives us and energizes us in life and gives us eternal life. The one excuse, though, that will never stand before the bar of God's judgment is that we have not been given enough clear knowledge of God. Ignorance will not be an excuse when you stand before Him in judgment. I just didn't know it enough. There are two well-known atheists that have been in America. Richard Dawkins is from England, Christopher Hitchens is from England, and they both came over to America, I guess because they stopped proselytizing atheism in England and had to come over to America to do it. But Richard Dawkins was asked, what will you stand? What will you do when you die if you find out that you were wrong and you stand before God? And he said in his arrogance with a smirk on his face, "Well, since you are real, why did you try so hard to conceal yourself?" I don't think that's what he would be saying. You know why? Because the word says, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess, Jesus Christ is Lord. He will fall before him and proclaim him as Lord. While the words were being still ringing in his ears, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you." Christopher Hitchens just died some time ago, earlier this year. He said, smirking at the same time in his intellectual arrogance, when he stands before God, if God even exists, he will say that the reason why I didn't believe in you is because you just didn't give me enough evidence. As if God owes us anything. The planets spin, the stars toil and are illuminated. Gravity, physics, life, creation, galaxies, human being, animals, all within the hand of God. All creation screams his name. And we, in our pursuit of gnosis, we have to have it all figured out. To liken ourselves unto God, where God owes us more information. The reason why Gnostics have so much trouble is because they don't, it's not because they don't understand things and because they don't have a mind to understand, they have a faith problem. Not a knowledge problem, they have a faith problem. God has made full provision for us. Everything, he says, pertaining to life and godliness. Again, life is eternal life. And it's a gift of God. Godliness is the means by which we can live an obedient life. And they both go hand in hand together, because where there is life, there must be growth. Where there is true life, where there is an understanding of a living hope and eternal life, there must be growth. There must be evidence that you belong to him, that you remain in him, and he remains in you, that you abide in him, and that he abides in you, of relationship. This begins at conversion. This never happens in anything that you can do on your own. This happens as a result of regeneration. It happens as a result of you being converted to something, for you to be transformed into something. Sanctification is not just what happens when you pray and ask Jesus into your heart. It is from your moment of transformation unto the day of glorification. It's all your life. But so many people are content with just carrying the book around, looking like a Christian and talking like a Christian, but they never know anything about it. How can that be? Guys, I can't urge you enough to pick up the book and to read the book and to understand the book and allow the Holy Spirit to do something in you. You say, man, there's big words in there. So what? You've got a big brain in there. There's concepts in there I don't get. There's words and terminology I don't understand. Are you limiting what the Spirit of God can do in your fallenness, in your impure minds, in your struggling heart? Where there's life, there must be growth. Please understand, where there is life, there must be growth. You call yourself a child of God, prove it. Show something. Everything pertaining to life and godliness through what? Epinosis. Through the true knowledge, the rich, deep knowledge that it comes from being in a covenant with someone and from being able to know someone. And then it says, he's the one who called us. Let me just stop on that for a second. He's calling us. And in most theological circles, there's two different types of calling. There is the general calling, which is the general proclamation to all people. This is what the angel said, I bring you good news of great joy, which is for all people. The good news is for everyone. Then he begins to talk about peace on earth, goodwill to men. Not all men will have peace. Not all men will experience goodwill with each other. Not all pleasure in the joy of Christ. This leads us to our second level. It is what is called the effectual call. The gospel call is for everyone. It is revealed in creation and revealed through the preaching of the gospel. The effectual call is the special call to the elect. These are the ones that God looks down and He chooses and He brings to Himself. Now, boy, I got to tell you, this call is greatly debated and is a hot topic of debate. And you know, you can debate it all you want to. The Bible, buckle up, folks, the Bible teaches election and that God chooses His own. Others, He allows them to choose their own rebellion, but some He will choose for Himself. Not all of us are God's children. He's choosing, He's electing some to be in His family. I don't understand it all, and I don't get it all, but beware of this. God is the one that's doing the choosing. He's the one that's starting this thing. That's why we call it irresistible grace. It's an irresistible call, because when He does call you, you can't run from that. Why? Because He's all-powerful. He's all-knowing. He knows what you're going to do before you're going to do it, and He will continue to draw you to Himself. That's the effectual call. Now, for my free willers here in the room, guess what? You're right, too. You have a free will. You have an opportunity to choose Him, too, but you have that opportunity. You have that ability based on what He's done in your life and based upon what He's doing for you. So guess what? You're both right. God's choosing, and you're choosing. Instructs us to do this. He says He's called you, the ones who have faith, the ones who have trusted in Him. He says, come, my children, come to me. Come to me. Trust me. This effectual call, this is the type of call that Peter's talking about all throughout his first letter. I've got a few examples for you here on the screen. In 1 Peter 2, it says that we've been called out of darkness. We were dead in our sins and our trespasses. We were spiritually dead. We were darkened. We had hard hearts, stony hearts. And it says He called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. In chapter 2 of 1 Peter, He says we've been called for this purpose. He's called us for this purpose. What is that purpose? It is through suffering. In chapter 3, it is through humility that we are called for this purpose. In chapter 5, called to eternal glory. We've been called out of darkness and transferred into the kingdom of His beloved Son. And in verse 10, in 2 Peter, which will be next week, is this: make certain about His calling and choosing you. This week, and if you'll notice on the front of your sermon notes, I've got the title of today's message is How to Know You're Saved. But it's part one. Today are the virtues of the saved. We're going to talk about those in just a minute. But we're also going to talk about next week the assurance of the saved, that you can know who you belong to and what He's calling you to. He's already provided for everything pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and excellence. Look at glory and excellence. In verse 4 it says, by these He has granted to us His precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of this divine nature. And you have not done so there, you can fill in your blanks there or fill in the margin there as you go, but I really need to move along. And when He says these precious and magnificent promises, this is not the first time we've heard Peter use the word precious. He likes this word. For those of you Lord of the Rings fans in there, what is this right here?
Precious.
It's my precious. It's the ring of power, right? It's what He constantly pursues. If you don't know anything about the Lord of the Rings, you don't know anything, all right? So this is just our marriage ring. But Lord of the Rings, this is what they're pursuing. It's the ring of power. It's the ring of knowledge and great power and understanding. And that's what they're going for. And this gangly little creature is He's had it. He's had it. And He's had it in His grasp. He's had it in His hands. He's had it, and He knows the power that it has. And then He loses it. He seems to lose everything. When we talk about precious, we're talking about something that is irreplaceable, something of infinite value. With this description of infinite value and irreplaceable, let's look at the other things that Peter talks about. Back in 1 Peter again, he talks about faith is more precious than gold. It says that the blood of Christ is the precious blood by which we are redeemed. In chapter 2 of 1 Peter, it says that we are living stones, choice and precious in the sight of God. We learn that Jesus is a precious cornerstone. In chapter 3, we understand that the gentle and quiet spirit of the wife is precious in the sight of God. In 2 Peter 1:4, which is where we are right now, these are precious, infinite value, irreplaceable and magnificent promises. This is God's word that has been given to us. Why? So that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature. What is the divine nature? It is the glory and excellence of Jesus. It's the glory and excellence of a God who saves. It's the glory and excellence of grace and mercy that He has given to us, and we may become partakers in this divine nature. Partakers meaning sharers or partners in this. This is the DNA of Christ Jesus, glory and excellence. And when we're saved, that DNA becomes a part of us as we become children of God. Warren Wiersbe had a great little section in his commentary. I want to just share a few of them with you as you fill in the blanks along these lines. He says, nature, by its definition, nature determines our appetite. Nature determines appetite. He says, the pig wants slop, and the dog will even eat its own vomit. But the sheep desires quiet, cool streams and green pastures in which to feed. Nature also determines our behavior. An eagle flies because it has an eagle's nature. A dolphin swims because it has the nature of a dolphin. The Dallas Cowboys win because they have the nature to just be awesome. Squirrels climb trees, moles burrow underground, and trout swim in the water. Guess what, folks? That's why Christians are in churches together. Enough of this nonsense out there that says, man, I know the Bible, and I can say the Bible wherever I go, and man, I can worship God wherever I go. Yes, you can do all those things, but because nature determines our environment, we should want to be together. Amen. And liken unto that, nature determines association. Lions travel in pride, sheep in flocks, and fish in schools. Christians should want to travel with other Christians and be with other believers. Wiersbe went on to say, if nature determines appetite, we have God's nature within, then we ought to have an appetite for that which is pure and holy. I'll say it again, where there is life, there must be growth. Where there is a relationship with God, there must be godly behavior. Thomas Schreiner in his book said, believers should live in a way that pleases God because Christ has given them everything they need for life and godliness. William MacDonald in his commentary says, God doesn't make us holy against our will or without our involvement. There must be desire, determination, and discipline on our part. There's something that we do. All of these other things have been blessings and resources that have been given by God to His children. So what should we do with it? What in the world should we do about these things? Because isn't that what we're always wanting? Give me the how-to manual. Give me the something that I'm supposed to do next. We find those in a list of virtues, eight virtues, in verses 5, 6, and 7. Look at verse 5. For this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, then supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge. And in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. Eight virtues that we see. This is what the Christian should look like. This is what the Christian should be pursuing. When we talk about life and growth, this is what should be growing in us. Each of these virtues is connected to the next. They are inseparably linked together. They build on top of each other. One commentator called it a staircase to glory. Another one said he called it the golden chain that leads to heaven. One of our elders in the church, Mike Huff, he led a small group Bible study through 2 Peter a couple years ago. And he shared some of his notes with me this week. And this was one of the diagrams that he gave. And what a great job he did of putting these things on top of each other. Faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, they just continue to build. They're sandwiched in between faith, the foundation, and love, which is a primary factor in all these and how all these kind of coexist and fit in between the two. Each virtue is connected to the next, but we build on a foundation of faith. It all begins here. Trusting God is faith. Trusting God is the root, then, from which all these other virtues spring. How are we going to get to glory? How are we going to get to heaven? It's through a trust in God. In every generation, great effort has gone into supplanting these virtues, though, looking for an easier way, looking for another way, something far less demanding. In the Gospel Transformation Bible, it says this note: the gospel is not opposed to effort, but it is opposed to earning. There is effort that we do. God gives us faith. He regenerates our hearts and minds so we can understand it, but there's still work to be done. That's why the author said, true faith sweats. I wrote that in the margin of my Bible right here, and I love that phrase, true faith sweats. There is effort involved in being a Christian. Look at the subtopics there. James 1:22 says that we need to be hearers and what? Doers of the word. James is going to say in the next chapter that faith without works is what, church? It's dead. It's useless. It's worthless. Philippians 2, Paul urges us to work out your salvation, not work for your salvation. Be careful to work out your salvation. So once you're saved, works come out of you. That's what that passage means. John 15 says that when we abide in him, he abides in us and we bear fruit. And that you will eventually be pruned. You'll be cut on. There will be difficult parts of you. Why? So you'll bear more fruit. Where is the evidence? Where is the sweat and the toil of working out of salvation in your life? This is not just a suggested virtue. This is a necessity. Without faith, without trusting God, there is nothing else. Upon faith is moral excellence. Your Bible may say goodness, or virtue, or praiseworthy, or something honorable. Moral excellence is doing the right thing regardless of the potential outcome. Doing the right thing regardless of what the potential outcome is. I can't tell you how many times, how much has gone on in the church knowing the right thing to do, knowing that the direction that God has set in His Word, knowing that this is what we should be doing, this is the path that we should be pursuing, but we fail and we stop and we stumble because someone might be offended.
Come on.
And because that someone has been chairman of the deacons for the last, 22 years, and his family are the biggest tithers in the church, we can't upset them. Who are they most concerned about in that regard? Themselves? Or the one who saved? Moral excellence is doing the right thing, the righteous thing, regardless of the potential outcome. Moral excellence is the natural outcome of our spiritual DNA, the glory and the excellence of God. When we become His children, we become partakers in the divine nature. That means His spiritual DNA becomes our spiritual DNA. This is how I define it this week. Divine nature in action. That's DNA. His divine nature in action in our lives. Glory and excellence at work. Upon faith, we build moral excellence. On moral excellence, we build unto knowledge. Here is epinosis again. This deeper, fuller, more intimate understanding. It is the truth properly understood and applied. Sometimes we don't know everything that you think you're supposed to know, but guess what? Through in-depth study and meditation, the Spirit of God is going to bring something into you. He's going to bring you to an understanding of what this means. He's going to bring you to an empowerment to know how to walk and to live in this understanding. Peter wants us to know God, not merely about God or this great creation that He's made. He really wants us to know Him deeper, fully. Sproul went on to say in his book, in his commentary, our approach to learning of God is not to be done in a frivolous, capricious, or cavalier manner. With earnest application, careful study, and inquiry, we are to apply ourselves diligently to every word that has proceeded from the mouth of God. This is where true knowledge and understanding needs to come from. Our ears should so perk up, our should be quickened, our eyes should be open to when somebody says, "Thus saith the Lord," we want to hear it. When we hear those words, all the books we've read, all the cute little bumper stickers that we've seen, the t-shirts that we wear, all the little colloquial sayings that are thrown out there, they all must bow underneath the proclamation of "Thus saith the Lord." Are you listening for that? Will you trust it? Will you know it when you hear it? David Helm and his Preaching the Word commentary said, "True knowledge of God is always attended by a fixed belief in God's promises. However, so often today, people want to claim relationship with God while at the same time they abandon the words of the Bible. It's as if we want a God in our own making, one who exists under the authority of our own word." Isn't that what we want? I want to dictate the terms. Time, Lord, I want you to save me, but I want to dictate all the other qualifications that go in that. It's not the way it works. Peter wants you to know him intimately. That's why he phrased it in the way that he phrased it. That's why he mentions it so many times. That's why he urges us in a time where false gospel and doctrinal error are all around us. He said, it's not so much important that you just know the right from the wrong. You got to know who the right is and who the wrong is. Know him. Knowing the Bible is the start. But knowing the Bible is what introduces you to knowing him in the first place. Reminds me of a story that I read this week. There was a big event in town, and several dignitaries and many people were invited to this big event. And there was a Hollywood actor that was invited to come, and he was there. And one of the old pastors that had been pastoring in the town was also invited to come and be a part. And they all invited him up to the stage at this big event. And the MC of the event decided, man, he needed to go off script a little bit. He wanted this famous Hollywood actor to come up and say a few words. Well, Hollywood actors are great because they're great memorizers and they're great actors. They're memorizing someone else's words and someone else's text. And so, caught on the spot, he didn't quite know what to say. So, as the applause is for him by just the mere mention of his name, he leans over to the pastor and says, "What should I say?" And the pastor says, "Here, take this." And he opened up to the 23rd Psalm, and as the man was coming to the table, the actor began to look and realize he remembered from Sunday school that he remembered the words. And he began in his eloquent phrasing, in his eloquent voice, to begin to say, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want." And he began to read in this beautiful text, with this beautiful language, and this beautiful voice. And after he was finished, he closed the book, and everyone cheered and cheered and cheered of the greatness and the power of that man and his reading of that great text that they all knew. And without a lot of other words to say, he said, "I'd like for my pastor friend to come up and share some words on that too." He didn't know how to respond. Everyone quieted down, and they wondered what the pastor would say. And he opened the book to the 23rd Psalm. And the heart of the shepherd began to read the text to a broken, lost community full of wandering sheep. And he read those six verses and was met total silence as it began to resonate in the room. He went back and he sat down, and the actor was dumbfounded and was awestruck at what he had just heard. And he leaned over to the pastor and he said, "You did so much better than I. For I knew the song, but you knew the shepherd." It changes things, doesn't it? What Peter is urging his listeners, his readers, his church friends and family to understand is that you are about to be undone. Whether it's through persecution and suffering, or whether it's through division and being overwhelmed by the false heresies that are getting ready to come to you, know the shepherd, know his word. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of the Son. Everything pertaining to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who calls, may it abound in you. May the Spirit of God lead us today to a knowledge, understanding of him. We build on faith with moral excellence. We build on moral excellence with knowledge. And on knowledge, we build self-control. And I'm going to exercise a little bit of this today because I have much to say on the topic, but there's not enough time in which to say it. So you're going to have to come back next week. You're going to have to practice a little self-control. Keep your fill-in-the-blanks empty until we come back next week. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Beside restful waters he leads me, and he restores my soul. That is my shepherd's prayer for you this week. Peter's prayer is, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. I'm asking you this week, what does it take to know him? To know the shepherd. It talks all about him here. If you will seek him, you will find him. You seek him with all your heart. We'll help you. There's new Bibles in our resource room today. Some of you have come to faith, and when you came to faith, and you came to be a follower of Jesus Christ, all you had was a little beat-up King James Bible that belonged to your grandmother. And it's near and dear to you, and I'm not ever going to tell you to go and scrap that thing. I have one on my shelf in there. I have an old Bible that was near and dear to me that my parents gave me when I was little, and I still have it handy. But some of you have a hard time reading certain texts, and you give up on it. We've provided some easier reading context, contextual in the right study methods of having those. Now, I preach on the New American Standard Bible. Billy preaches out of the ESV, the English Standard Version. There are other translations in there too. Use them. Compare them with what you have. Begin to try to understand. One of the first and easiest ways that you can work with Bible study is get a different translation and begin to compare so that God's Spirit may try to sow deeper into you an understanding of the text. We want to help with that. That's why we provide books and Bible tools. There's Bible atlases in there. There's Bible dictionaries in there. There's ways for you to grow in this. Please don't use it as an excuse that I just can't understand it. You belittle the Spirit of God when you do that. May we know him. May we know him as the sheep hear the shepherd's voice. May we respond to him. From the very beginning today, we see the same power. The same power that rose Jesus from the dead, that moves mountains when he speaks, that the same power that calms a raging sea lives in us. And how did we respond to that song? Lord, may the power of your love change me. That's the way we began today. That's the way we're going to close. I'm going to ask some of the band to come up, and we're just going to play. Some of the singers, if you're still in here, y'all come up and help me out a little bit. The power of your love is changing me. Everything has been set apart. Everything is different now because you know the shepherd and the shepherd knows you. Will you begin to act like that? Will you begin to live in that? This message today is for believers. It's not for all people. Peter was writing to Christians. This message today is to Christians. Do you know him? Will you respond to him when he teaches you? Let's stay in love you. Come back next week. We're going to pick it up with self-control. All right? We're just going to hurt your feelings as soon as we get started next week. All right? So just go ahead and come. Put your steel-toe boots on. We're going to get into that. And then we're going to get and move into making sure that we know that we know that we know we belong here. Amen, church? I'll see you at the door.
Hey, Melissa Morris wanted me to remind you guys, if you came through the door today, you saw a couple of quilts out there on the rack. There's a ministry here called Sowers. And what they do, there's several women that meet here occasionally. They don't meet here, they meet at her house. And they begin to take old quilt clippings and stuff like that, and they begin to sew, and there's a ministry that's involved in that. And a lot of these quilts are going to be donated to the Women's Crisis Pregnancy Center. So if you would like to be a part of this, find Melissa Mitchell and talk to her or call the church office so we can get you involved in this ministry. If you like sewing or if you like being part of this. Look, what'd I say? Well, I was looking back here. I was thinking Michelle. So I said, but anyway, but if you're interested in sewing, just get up with Melissa Morris and she can get you involved in this ministry. And these ladies love getting together and just sewing. But right out here in the lobby, is two of the projects they're starting. So,
hey, real quick, let me tell you this real quick too. Melissa shared with me yesterday, they just had their big crisis pregnancy center, a big thing over at Long Hollow. They said the place was packed out. They said they gave some statistics. 17 years ago, we're in the class of 2000, the seniors are the class of 2017 right now. 17 years ago, tracing from there up until today, there's been about 20, right now there's 2,500 seniors in the Sumner County area and the high schools. There are 2,500 seniors that are about to graduate. And there's been like 2,480-something lives that have been spared that did not abort their babies, that went ahead and had their babies. We're looking at a potential class of 2017 that exists because 17 years ago, someone cared enough to be a part of this ministry. And that stat that they gave to me just blew me out of the water and realized, man, there are seniors graduating today that may not have ever been here, if not for this ministry. So I just wanted to share that with you. Those things are important.
That's cool. Also, we got a special announcement. Chef, come on up. Some of you have heard of this ministry here. There's a table out in the lobby called Kairos, but she wants to come up and tell you a little bit about more of what's going on in their ministry.
Hi everybody, I'm going to be real quick so you can get some lunch. Kairos, we're going back into the Tennessee Prison for Women this fall on October the 27th through the 30th. Most of you know that Kairos from previous times we've gone inside the prison, but if you're new to the church, please stop and see Amy and I in the lobby. We're happy to explain it to you and go into more detail. In your bulletin, you have colored strips. A little less structure to it this time around. You can say, I'm praying for you on this weekend. You can give a word of encouragement. You can include a Bible verse, whatever you want. We put them together, we make a giant paper chain, we bring it into the ladies, it's agape. We're restricted in how we can show agape love to these ladies. This is one way the prison approves us to bring it inside. The next thing we'd like you to do, if you can, we'd like you, above and beyond your tithe, if you're able to help us with meals. We prepare three meals a day for these ladies, and at their plate, we put these cards. And what we tell them is, you know, somebody on the outside, unbeknownst to them, has paid for that meal, and they've made a $5 donation so that meal could be brought to them. Ladies are very moved by this and would like to be able to bless them with these cards again. If you're able to give, we ask for a $5 donation for each card, and it helps defray some of the expenses the team has to come up with to pay for these meals. We have Faith Church envelopes here. If you make a check out to Faith Church and indicate in the other box that this is for Kairos. Well, the church will make sure that it cycles back to us and it goes into the Kairos treasury. Again, thank you for your time. But cookies. Cookies first. Cookies! We are not making cookies this time. They kind of change the rules on us. We have to have commercial made cookies. They have to be sealed. Amy and I, we're going to go in to Walmart or Sam's Club or someplace and get those new cookies in the packages. If you want to help us with the expense of those cookies, we would greatly appreciate it. We have to go in with 18 dozen apiece because the annex is a little smaller than the main prison, which is where we go in the spring. So we have less cookies to have to make or bring. If you can help us with that, that would be greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Sumner County Worship Choir, Nazarene Church at 6.
6 o'clock tonight. Sumner County Worship Choir is at Galton Nazarene Church at 6 o'clock tonight. Also, they said 18 dozen apiece. Is that right? 18 dozen cookies? So y'all need to bring 37 dozen cookies to this place. Okay? 37 dozen cookies. 18 for them, for each partner, and one for me. Okay? Right spot. Okay? So let's stand together and let's close in a word of prayer today. Father God, we just thank you. Father, we thank you that we can come into a place and Lord, just hear truth. Lord, we thank you that for our pastor, our shepherd who guides us to those truths. Lord, I do say this tonight or today. No sermon will grow us spiritually. So, Lord, I pray that we would have that heart and that discernment to dive into your scriptures and to grow and to know you more on an intimate level. Lord, I pray that each and every person in here today would be stirred and allow the Holy Spirit to guide them into the truth. Lord, that this just wouldn't be a place of gathering, a place of just occupying a chair, but Lord, there would be actual growth that takes place because we're learning and growing from you. Father, we thank you today that we came in and we were able to sing your songs. Lord, we were hoping your word. Lord, what a tragedy would be the things that we've seen here and heard here would take it and just set it aside and do nothing about it. Lord, we just pray that you continue to challenge us. That's through your spirit. Lord, we thank you for loving us. Thank you for calling us your children. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Hey.